Well, good morning, everyone, joining us by Facebook and YouTube here at White House History Live. This is a special edition coming to you from historic Decatur House on Lafayette Square, just about 200 yards from the north door of the White House. Today, we have a wonderful guest, Pete Souza, who is the best-selling author, and for 8 years was the chief White House photographer for President Obama, headed the White House Photography Office, and was also a presidential photographer for President Reagan. We have much to talk about. Gathered with us here today in Decatur House is a wonderful audience of friends of the White House Historical Association. Many of you have covered the White House for years in either journalism, television, radio, photography, and it's great to have you with us as well. So let's dive in and have our first question to Pete. Do you remember what the circumstances were, how old you were, the very first time you visited the White House?
I do. It was in 1965.
Okay.
My parents took myself and my sister Jane to D.C. and we toured Washington, and we visited the White House. We went on the White House tour. We have no photos
from
that visit. Do you know why?
Why is that?
Because photos were not allowed on the White House tour. Until Michelle Obama,
that's right,
is the one who changed that policy.
Wow.
And the other thing I remember was at one point we were walking along Pennsylvania Avenue right in front of the White House. This is back in the day where that was open to cars.
Sure, sure.
And this big black limousine was driving by slowly, and it kind of slowed down, and the back window rolled down, and Lady Bird Johnson waved at us.
Oh, wow.
And I did subsequently, 25 years later, I did get to tell Lady Bird Johnson
that
story.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
But no photograph of that either.
No photograph of that. Okay. I mean, part of it was I was not really that interested in taking pictures until I took a photo class in college many
years really?
Later. Yeah. I was not one of these, you know, kids that was drawn to photography right away, although I will say that I was in fourth grade when Kennedy was assassinated, and the next day that famous picture by Cecil Stout of LBJ getting sworn in really was a profound moment, so much so that I cut that picture out of the newspaper and taped it to my bedroom closet door. Wow. So clearly, even as a really young kid, still photographs were speaking to me, not knowing that someday, you know, this would be
sure.
my profession.
That's really powerful. So how did your career evolve into photography, and how did you end up at the doorstep of the White House as a photographer for President Reagan?
You know, luck played so much of a role in my career, just like the way things happen. Mm-hmm. So I ended up going to Boston University, took a photo class, realized that that was my passion. And I ended up working for small newspapers in Kansas and then the Chicago Sun-Times. Mm-hmm. When in 1983, I got a phone call from the White House photo editor, who was working for Michael Evans, Reagan's chief photographer, and she said, "We want you to apply for this job." And I told her no. I was
really?
Not interested.
Oh,
yeah.
No.
I was doing so well
that?
In Chicago that I was like, I'm not ready to leave. And I probably went home that night thinking about that picture of Cecil Stout and some of the other pictures that I'd seen over the years from the White House, and I'm like, what, am I crazy to turn down this opportunity? So I called her back the next morning, came to D.C., interviewed, and they hired me. So that's the way that happened.
Well, you obviously build a rapport with the people that you photograph, particularly for a period of time, and you covered the Reagan presidency, and then there came a time when President Reagan died many years later, and his body is being brought back to Washington for the funeral. And you have this iconic, moving, emotional photograph of Mrs. Reagan on the presidential plane bringing them back. How do you meld into the wall? How do you become there but not there with someone having such a personal moment? And tell us about this experience of being with her in that very powerful moment for her personally?
Yeah, I mean, it was, I sort of knew many years before that that I would be asked to mm-hmm. to photograph the funeral for the Reagans. And so when he died, I flew out to California, and, you know, I had a relationship with Mrs. Reagan that was, you know, quite intimate in many ways, because you end up, as a White House photographer, being in very intimate situations.
Sure.
So I had this previous relationship with her, and I was there on their behalf, and mm-hmm. but it was also documenting history.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to say, it was very eerie to see the casket on Air Force One, to see those guest seats on the plane had been removed, and they strapped the casket in the guest cabin of Air Force mm-hmm. One. And President Bush was nice enough to send Air Force One out to California mm-hmm. to pick up Reagan's casket. So it's very eerie to just mm-hmm. see it sitting back there. And then at one point, as the picture shows, Mrs. Reagan came back with her son Ron and Ron's son Doria. And, you know, I just kind of like looked at her, and she looked at me, mm-hmm. and I knew it was okay to be there. Mm-hmm. And no words were exchanged, mm-hmm. but I felt that my presence there was wanted. And it's just kind of a gut feeling, really, because this is as intimate a situation as you can possibly see. I mean, there's nobody else back there except for me and the three of them. So a very intimate moment.
Mm. Well, the White House obviously is filled with times of sorrow and sadness and joy and rejoicing. And there was a time, one of those times is when there are these celebratory visits to the White House. We recently had the state visit of President Mrs. Macron came to the White House, as you all know. But there was an iconic time when there was the visit of the then Prince and Princess of Wales to the White House. And this is a photo that I think everyone has seen. And former White House Social Secretary Gail Burt, who's on our board, takes credit for aligning this to make happen. But I want to hear your perspective as well. And there's something that I notice about this photo that is a little bit of a tell to me. Notice in the background, Mrs. Reagan and then the Prince of Wales, Prince Charles, are oblivious to what's going on the entrance hall. They are in their own little world of conversation, and he's paying no attention to his wife, who's stealing the show. So tell us about this image and how this came about, and any other moments like this in your years there.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, that certainly was an amazing night, and it was surreal in so many ways. I mean, given my age, I knew John Travolta from the TV show Welcome Back, Cotter.
Oh, Welcome Back, Cotter. Okay.
You know, which is like going way back. And, you know, and then, from obviously Saturday Night Fever. And the band actually struck up a medley from that movie. That's what the Marine band was playing. And it was so surreal. And if you look really closely, Diana is blushing. And in the moment, you could really see the cheeks turning red as she's dancing with apparently what was her, you know, favorite movie star. I'm looking at that Secret Service agent in the background, just over the hands. Yes. And I remember talking to him right after this. And I was like, can you believe what just happened? I remember saying that to him because it was so surreal that this had just happened.
So are there moments like this when you take a photograph, you know that is going to be as iconic as it becomes?
Well, I knew that I had captured some special moments. I have like dozens of them, pictures of them mm-hmm. dancing. Mm-hmm. She also danced with Neil Diamond.
Mm.
And Neil Diamond at one point, while he was dancing with her, was singing to her.
Oh my goodness.
It was like, you know, and she danced with Tom Selleck and Clint Eastwood too.
Oh my goodness.
I could be wrong on that.
Did she dance with Prince Charles?
She danced with President Reagan. Let's
okay,
put it that
go.
Way.
There you go. There you go. Well, that's quite an occasion, and obviously we could cover thousands of photographs from the Reagan presidency, but you end that presidency, and then years go by. It's 2005, and you're covering a young junior senator from Illinois by the name of Barack Obama. You're back at the Chicago Tribune. Tell us about the evolution of that relationship and then ending up with him at the White House.
Yeah, again, it was lucky, another lucky coincidence in that I happened to be working as the Washington-based photographer for the Chicago Tribune. I was doing stories around the country, around the world, had gone to Afghanistan, all kinds of things. But when the hometown guy gets elected to the Senate, you know, it was kind of a big deal, and he was already being talked about as, you know, a future, you know, national leader. And so we pitched the story. Jeff Zeleny, now with CNN, was then a Tribune correspondent with me in the Tribune Bureau in D.C. So we pitched this story to document Obama's first year in the Senate. And because we were the hometown newspaper, you know, especially me, I got access that nobody else got. And, you know, I struck up, you know, when you're in somebody's close space like that, you have to develop some kind of a relationship, a professional relationship, not friendship. And he got, you know, that gave him a chance to see the way I worked, which, you know, the way I work is just be as unobtrusive as possible and try to capture things as they happen. Yeah. And so I think he appreciated the way I worked. And, you know, I ended up following him for the first 2.5 years in the Senate. And I actually did not cover the campaign except here and there, but kind of kept in touch with him and his staff. Mm-hmm. And then I tell people the story. This is so true. 2 weeks after, or I guess only a week after the election, I had covered the event in Grant Park. And a week or so after the election, I sent Robert Gibbs an email that had no message to it. It just had a subject line. Mm-hmm. And it just said, "I'm interested."
Oh, my goodness.
That was how I applied for the job.
Well, that was successful. So you didn't turn it down this time.
No, I did not. And the fact, you know, the big difference between doing Reagan and Obama is I became the chief photographer.
Yes.
I was a seasoned guy. I knew how the White House worked. I had known Barack Obama for 4 years just as a human being. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, before I took the job, I said to him, "I got to have total access, unfettered access. I can't be kept out of anything." And he agreed.
How did you were the chief photographer for Obama and a photographer during Reagan, two different roles, but compare those two experiences, the men as president, the White House itself, and comparison of the role for you.
You know, a lot of similarities in the way the White House worked between the two. You know, things didn't. You know, I mean, I knew how the White House worked, just the logistics of it. And it was like almost identical with Obama, you know, just the way the paperwork flowed, you know, the way the motorcades worked, the way Air Force One worked, you know, manifests. I knew all that stuff, and that stayed pretty much the same. Mm. Obviously, technology had changed a huge amount, but the logistics were kind of the same. Here's the one thing that the two presidents had in common is they both had this very even-keeled disposition where, you know, they didn't get rattled that much. Mm-hmm. I saw them get rattled, both of them. I saw them both get pissed off. Is it okay to say that?
Sure.
but it would take a lot to do that with both of them. And I think, you know, in many ways, you know, I think from what I observed that that's probably a good characteristic for a president to have, to be able to, because so much is being thrown at you every day, that if you're going to blow up over every little thing, it's going to be not a fun job.
Well, you're taken into the confidence of the president and of the country, really. You've probably spent more time in the Oval Office other than any president would have. Do you see things, hear things that you have to keep confidential? Are you part of the mechanics of that secrecy?
Oh, of course. I mean, so I had during Reagan, I had a top secret clearance. During Obama, I had a top secret SCI, so the next, the next level up, so that I could be in the room when they were talking about that, you know, that kind of information. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't privy to paperwork. mm-hmm. you know, which is where everything's written down, sure. the super top secret classified information. You know, I wasn't privy to that, but obviously I overheard them discussing that kind of information. Mm-hmm. And when you get a security clearance like that, there's a whole process.
They ever ask you your opinion on anything? I'm joking.
Well, Reagan did one time, and Obama did a few times, yeah.
Okay, there's this amazing photograph that everyone will recognize here, and it's during the Obama presidency in the capturing of Osama bin Laden. When you were taken into the Situation Room where this photograph was taken, did you have any idea what the subject matter was going to be?
Yeah. So about a week before John Brennan, that you see in the top right-hand corner, second from the right, was the Homeland Security Advisor at the time. Mm. And an aide in his office had come to me maybe a week or 10 days before and said, whatever you do, don't go anywhere, you know, next weekend. And and she said to me, I'm not sure if it's going to be Saturday or Sunday. And that was the trigger for me that this was a special ops, mm-hmm. because I knew it was weather dependent, right? Sure. So I knew it was some sort of special ops. And then, later, I guess maybe the day before, I figured out what was going on. And, you know, earlier that day, this picture was made, you know, around 4 o'clock DC time. But around 1 o'clock, he had his first meeting in the Situation Room that afternoon. This was on a Sunday. And they went over the final details. So I knew, you know, for sure, 100%, maybe 3 hours before it happened. Mm.
So you're seeing them and their faces through the lens of your camera as they're watching this unfold. How do you right. stay focused on them and not get captured into what's happening?
Well, there's not to say that I didn't, but look, I knew this was a historic day, and but we didn't know how it was going to turn out.
Sure.
Right? This could have been This could have been the event that made him a one-term president.
You see some fear and doubt on the faces of.
I think the best way to put it is, you got essentially the most powerful people in the executive branch of our government all jammed into this tiny room. Mm. And in those 40 minutes, they are 100% powerless, right? It's completely up to those special forces guys on the ground. You know, these are the guys that make the decisions.
Yes.
They had made the decision to launch this raid. He had made the decision to launch this raid. Now there's nothing he can do.
Yes.
So I think, you know, you can just imagine the tension.
Sure.
And several of those guys, I mean, everyone in that room was aware of Carter's mission in 1979 or what, I can't remember what year it was, when he launched that rescue mission to try to get our hostages out of Iran, and it was a complete debacle. Helicopters crashed, people died. That's got to be on their minds
absolutely,
as well.
Absolutely. Well, let's shift gears a little bit, and there's another photograph that is a very popular photograph, and this is Jacob Philadelphia reaching up over and touching President Obama's head. And I understand this was one of the president's favorite photographs as well. Give us the scenario and why you like this.
So his dad, Carlton Philadelphia, was on the National Security Council. He was, I think he worked for the State Department, and they assigned people to the National Security Council at the White House, non-political. He had actually worked during the Bush administration, had carried over to the Obama administration. 5 months into the Obama administration, he was headed to a foreign post somewhere. So as a courtesy, President Obama invited the family in for what was supposed to be just a quick greet and photo standing in front of the desk. Right. And then young Jacob, I think he was five at the time, had the presence of mind to say, Mr. President, my friends tell me that my haircut is just like yours.
Wow.
And with that, Barack Obama bent over, Jacob touched his head. This happened so fast. Look, I've cut his dad's head off. So compositionally, not the perfect composition, but the fact that I precisely got the moment, because there's only one picture, one click, but you can see his eyes and you see his hand touching his head. And like, I didn't even know what I had, even though with a digital camera, you look on the back of the camera, because like, you know, there was like all kinds of stuff going on that day. I never really looked at the back of my camera. And later that day, one of the photo editors that was looking through my take from the day sent me the photo and he said, look at this. And I was like, oh, that's a pretty cool photo. And I probably didn't realize the significance of how the African-American community would react, that you've got this young black kid touching the head of the President of the United States that looks like him.
That's right.
And how much that resonated with people.
Wow.
And just that just kind of grew over time.
Wow.
One postscript on this is Jacob is 18 now. And both President Obama and I separately did a Zoom with him earlier this year.
Oh, how great.
And he graduated from high school, uh-huh. and he's now at the University of Memphis majoring in political science.
Wow. That's fantastic. Well, the image that comes to mind to me when I look at this photo is he's standing right in front of that door on the desk where John Kennedy came
yep.
through. Probably a little bit younger than he was in that picture. And just so through the eyes of a child and the magic of the Oval Office is a very powerful thing. I love that photo.
It was, we had this, we would hang these, what we called jumbos on,
yes.
along the walls of the West Wing. This had been a tradition back that I think went back to the Nixon days, where the photography office would curate photos and put them up on the wall. So when people, when staff and Secret Service give their friends and family tours of the West Wing at night, they get to see the Oval Office, the cabinet room, but then as they're walking in, they get to see all these cool behind-the-scenes pictures, right? So this picture was up, and we would rotate pictures out, put new ones up, and we kept this one up, and it caught the attention of Jackie Combs, a New York Times reporter. She ended up doing a story about it. Mm. And then about year five, I finally took it down, right? And I had like three different senior staffers come into my office and say, can you put that picture back up?
Oh, wow.
Because what would happen is when they were given the tours at night of the West Wing, they would stop in front of the photo
oh.
and tell their guests the story. And then it went back up and it stayed up till January 20th.
Well, I know we have a couple of members of our board here, Anita McBride and Bob McGee, and I know Anita will remember there used to be a tradition where senior staff would walk through
right.
and you would sign your name on the
right.
back. And
I stopped that.
Taken down. The most senior person got the photograph.
I stopped that because it got out of control. You know, then, so what we did, what the process we changed it to was like once every 2 weeks or something, my office manager would send out an email to the staff mm-hmm. saying, we're going to be checking out the old jumbos for you to hang in your office mm-hmm. at this day, at this time. And so people would line up
oh, wow.
and they'd get to choose the one they wanted. And it was a much more efficient way of doing it.
Well, talking about efficiency, last time I was at the Reagan Library, their images were still on contact strips and three-ring binders.
Right.
And now millions of photographs are digitally taken.
Right.
So contrast that for us, and even the number of clicks or images, O'Reagan to Obama, was it hundreds of thousands versus millions, or how did that compare?
Yeah, I honestly don't know how many photographs during Reagan. I don't know. During the Obama administration, I personally shot 1.9 million photos.
My goodness.
And the total for the staff was 4 million. So another 2 million from Mrs. Obama events, Vice President Biden events,
Absolutely.
Things like that. And, you know, one of the things that I'm proud of, not just, you know, the photos that I made, but we made a concerted effort that every photograph had an AP style caption.
Mm.
The photo archivists would go back in and enter if there were 10 people or less in the photo she would go in and identify every single person and then do keywords, which you can do digitally, so that every single image has all that information attached to it now at the National Archives. So for, you know, for years to come, that will be invaluable
For researchers.
Whereas with like the Reagan Library now, it's very difficult to like go and pinpoint and find a certain photo. You really need to find you need to know the date. It's hard to say.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So it's digital has made it much easier for researchers going forward, for sure.
And a much more comprehensive coverage of that presidency, I would imagine.
Yes, yeah, for sure.
Well, let's go to our online viewers who have submitted some questions. And this may require you to be a little diplomatic in a response. But this is Joanne from Facebook, and she wonders, what is your favorite White House photo that is not yours? And do you have a favorite White House photographer other than yourself?
That's easy question. I mean, Yoshio Okamoto was LBJ's photographer, and he is he's the best ever. He had an interesting character as his main subject, let's face it. But he was also a phenomenal photographer.
Wow.
I would probably choose one of his, although I worked with a guy named Jack Keitlinger, who had worked as one of the White House staff photographers for, I think, 3 or 4 administrations. And he worked with us during the first term of Reagan and worked under Oki, too, Yoshio Okamoto. And there was a time when LBJ had fired Okamoto for like a week or something like that. And Jack has like one of my favorite photos. It's a picture of LBJ alone in the cabinet room. And in the foreground is a tape recorder. And he's listening to a narration from Chuck Robb, who had been sending tapes from Vietnam to his wife, the president's daughter. White House Communications would take those cassette tapes and try to improve the sound quality, and they put them on a reel-to-reel. And LBJ is listening to the horrors of what he's reporting, and his head is bent down. It's just a really dramatic photo.
Wow. The next question is from a YouTube viewer in Belgium, and this is a question that I actually had down to ask you later. If you could go back in history, back to any early American president or former American president,
Lincoln,
be their photographer, who would it be and why? And
yeah, Abraham Lincoln.
Image would you want it to capture in that presidency?
Well, I mean, we really don't know what images existed during Lincoln, because, you know, photography then was such that in order to do, you know, there are many pictures of Lincoln, but they're all like post shots where he's having to hold still for like a second or longer, right? So photography was not nearly advanced, obviously, as it was, you know, even 50 years later. I saw Steven Spielberg's movie Lincoln, and I'm thinking, like, my God, there would have been amazing images if you were documenting what Lincoln was going through and just, you know, the tumultuous time for our country. So definitely Lincoln.
Wow. So here's a question also from Facebook. How do presidents differ in the image of a photograph when you see them and how they are in real life when you're not taking their photograph? Do they differ or are they the same?
I'm not sure I understand that question. They are who they are. I mean, I think I remember with Reagan especially, I had no prior relationship with him at all. I knew him from TV. And then all of a sudden you're, you know, in his inner sanctum. And you see him just like as a regular guy. I mean, I don't mean to diminish it that much, but you see that, he, you know, puts his shoes and socks on just the way I do. I mean, you sort of forget that about our presidents. They're just
real
like
people.
Normal people.
Yeah. And what about the family, accessing family moments and feeling the privacy of that and knowing what should be private and personal and what should be official?
The way I guess with President Obama, the way I looked at it was if his kids were interacting with him, then I was going to photograph it. But at the same time, I've got this one picture in my first book where he's sitting out on the swing set with his daughter, Malia, mm-hmm. who had just gotten home from school one afternoon, and he left the Oval Office and went out and sat next to her, and they're having a father-daughter conversation. I want to make that picture, which I did, but at the same time, you've got to realize, you know, there's an intuitive sense. You got to say to yourself, I don't need to be, you know, eavesdropping on this conversation. Mm. So you make a few pictures and then you back away and you let them have their moment. Mm-hmm. About 2 years in to the administration, I called Melissa Winter, who is Michelle's deputy chief of staff, and I said, I want to meet with Mrs. Obama about the family. Mm-hmm. And so I went into her office and I just put it this way to her. I said, I just want you to let me know how I'm doing documenting the family. Mm-hmm. Is it too much? Is it not enough? Is it just right? And she said it was just right. And I felt good. I felt that I was doing it just right.
Absolutely.
But and then it got to the point where they would ask me to do some things in the private residence that I didn't even know was happening. Mm-hmm. There was one time when Sasha was taking a Taekwondo test in the solarium because it was going to be too much of a hassle for her to take, for the president and first lady to take the motorcade somewhere to do it. And so they brought the teacher to the White House. Right. And, you know, they called me up and I came in on a Sunday. So and those are the most important pictures to him, are the ones with his family. So he doesn't care about, well, I mean, you know, the other pictures of himself didn't mean as much to him personally as the ones with Sasha, Malia, and Michelle.
Sure. And they will treasure those, I'm sure, as a family for years. In knowing them in their body language, could you take cues or clues from them as to when to back off or come closer?
Yeah. I mean, it's intuitive. It's an intuitive sense. I mean, and I think this helped that I always say seasoned rather than older guy during the Obama administration, because I had been through so much in my career, and you know, I just had a good sense for when I needed to just back away.
So this is RJ from Facebook who asks, what photo of yours from this wonderful book are you most fond of from your time in the White House?
You know, it's sort of like the same with any of my books. It's hard to like narrow it down to any one picture. I think my favorite section in the book is it's called Inside the Spare. You know, the Spare was the decoy limousine. You know the Beast. Well, it was identical to the Beast, but it was decoy. Think about that name, decoy. I mean, and it was just kind of like a series of pictures from my perspective sitting in that. Wow. Car showing people out the window and the Secret Service driver in front of me, you know, up in the front seat. And so I think that's my favorite section in the book.
During the Obama presidency, any photo that you miss that you wish you'd got?
During the Obama administration? Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are pictures in Russia and China when they didn't let me in the room that I missed, you know.
Wow, that's a shame. That would have been pretty powerful.
Yeah.
Well, let's go to our audience.
Was not my friend.
Does he have an official photographer? Does he have the access?
Yeah, no, he has a guy that is kind of a spooky guy that was not very friendly to me, but wow. I would see him from time to time.
Those would be interesting photos to rummage through.
Yeah.
Amy is going to do questions from our audience. Does anybody in the audience have a question? Anita, here we go.
Anita and I go way back.
Yeah, we do, and it's
now,
great
Anita
to
was
see
chief
you.
Of staff to First Lady Laura Bush and also worked in other presidencies. So
well, she worked in the Reagan
administration. I worked in the Reagan administration. Yeah. That's why I got to know Pete and know his incredible work. And I wanted to ask you the experience for you personally, for you were now with two presidents, not only during their years, but the day they left. And what that experience, was it emotional for you? Were you still just focused on the history of the transition of that day and their final moments in the White House? Mm-hmm. If you can talk about the two, President Reagan and President
Obama.
Yeah,
you know, Anita, I have done, I don't want to say hundreds, but dozens and dozens of talks that involve Q&A And no one has ever asked me that question.
Oh, wow, very good.
Because you are who you are. I mean, I think that with Reagan, it was very much focused on the history of that day. I mean, we were transitioning to his vice president, who is going to become the new president. So that, you know, is very smooth, and I was just focused on, you know, making the pictures. And matter of fact, I did the same picture for both of those days, which was I got a ladder from the GSA to make a wide angle shot of President Reagan leaving the Oval Office for the last time. And I ended up doing that's the only time I did the exact same picture, for President Obama. Mm. The difference, though, on that day was profound, this meeting for the last day of Obama, in that I was physically spent. Mm. You know, I put everything into the 8 years. I was there every day. I gave up like every birthday, funeral. You know, don't feel sorry for me. I did it to myself. But I was physically and I guess probably mentally exhausted and ready to leave. And I had a countdown clock on my phone and all that kind of stuff. And so there was that emotion. And, you know, not to get too political, but that, you know, I was quite concerned about who we were turning the keys over to. I was concerned for the country. And so there were those dual emotions playing out that day, of relief that it was done, that I was going to have to get rid of my BlackBerry, finally, but just of concern for the country.
What follow up for you on that is: do you know who you're handing the camera over to become on January the 20th when they change?
Yeah, I did, from Obama to Bush, I mean from Reagan to Bush, David Valdez, who had been vice president, I keep like saying Biden instead, but Vice President Bush's photographer, he was going to become the new chief. And then with Trump, I didn't find out until 2 days before, when I got a call from Shayla Craighead that she was actually on a tryout. She didn't have the full-time job yet. They were giving her a tryout for the first week. And so I knew that maybe she called me, I think, 2 days before the inauguration.
So initially that was the changing of the guard with the camera. So yeah. Do you recall the last photograph you took of President Obama as president?
You mean like before noon?
Yes, before noon.
Probably as he's on the dais at the Capitol, turned around watching Trump enter. Mm. You know, somewhere around there, it became 12 o'clock. Mm. You know, I know the last picture, probably the last picture I took that day, which was, you know, on Air Force One, because he got to use Air Force One one last time, and they flew to California.
And did you go to California?
I did, yeah.
And so what was the last picture that day?
Probably one of the things he did was, it's like I can't even remember the exact last picture, but one of the final things he did was he did an individual photo with each member of the Air Force One crew on the plane. And I remember at one point the pilot came in and I was like, let's do this really quick.
That's great. Next audience question. Did you have one? Need the microphone? Amy?
Okay. I think I'll ask one and then they'll pass it over.
Yeah, sure.
Fantastic. Right. Yeah. Oh, okay. Do you want me to pass the mic over? Okay, I'll ask one first.
Okay.
Great. Hi, I'm Amy Shank. I'm with the British Embassy, Washington. And I know we talked about Diana, Foreign Princess Diana, and the famous photo with John Travolta. Do you have any other fun stories from any other royal visits that you did with either president for the Brits?
So let's say the royals are not great for access, especially when you're on their turf, right? However, when President Obama and Michelle were going to visit Kensington Palace, to visit Prince William and Princess Kate, I got a call the night before from our advance team, and they said, you know, Prince William really wants you to be there, and we want to get you inside before the Obamas actually walk in the room, because Prince George is going to, they're going to keep him awake. I think he was 2 at the time. And so it was all very coordinated. I show up in the spare limousine, I get out, and there's some guy. He goes, we're going to go through the kitchen. You know, go through the kitchen, and then I'm in the living room before, because Prince had gone out to meet the Obamas at the motorcade, and then they were walking in the room. So I was in there, like, for a long time. They gave me, like, total access. So I got these pictures of Prince George on his rocking horse and stuff like that. And, of course, at one point, Prince George came over and shook hands with President Obama. President Obama knelt down and shook his hand. I got that picture. And, of course, I was thinking to myself, I can't believe 30 years before, you know, I made a picture of his grandmother dancing with John Travolta, right? And then, so the funny part of the story was, it was finally time for him to go to bed, Prince George to go to bed. And so their nanny came to get him, picks him up, and she's walking out of the room, and they stop in front of me, and the nanny says, say thank you to the gentleman, meaning me. And Prince George looks at me and goes, thank you very much. You know?
That's
the funniest,
great.
Yeah.
That's great. Our next question, right back here.
Hi, Dino Zonga. Thank you so much for being here. My question is, this day and age with the 24-hour news cycle, people really psychoanalyze pictures and body language a lot. Is there a picture which everyone thinks they have the story, but you being in the room where, like, this is not what happened, that's not what they were thinking?
Oh, that happened all the time. So one of the things that I had said to the White House staff was, because they wanted to start this Flickr photo stream where every month we would put up a series of behind-the-scenes pictures, right? And I was the holdout. I was the one who said, I don't know if this is a good idea or not. And it took them like 5 months to convince me. And then what I finally said to them, I said, you have to let me curate the photos. You can say no and, you know, to any photos that you don't want out there, but I don't want you like going through every single photo. You got to let the experts that know how to choose photographs. And then we'll present them to you and you can say, you know, I don't know about this one. So that's the way that went. Subsequently, there was this guy, Michael Shaw, who started this nonprofit called Reading the Pictures. And he would read the pictures, meaning he would write, he would analyze them. And like, he would write stuff that I was like, what are you talking about? Like, it was like, I put this picture out because this was a really stressful economic meeting, and I was trying to show people authentically what it was like. And then he would like conjure up, the White House was trying to do this and show this, and it was like, that was not it at all. So that happened all the time.
What did you look for when you were hiring another White House photographer?
People that had a background in photojournalism who would fit in the White House environment, who would pass a security clearance, and who were just, you know, the right fit for the job. I mean, I had a list of like 12 people that I had, you know, that I was going to consider, and then just kind of like interviewed them and kind of just whittled it down based on those. And then it's just like a gut, and you know, like kind of everything in my life, you make gut judgments on people, right?
Right. Do you ever get together with other former White House photographers and talk about experiences?
Yeah, occasionally. I mean, David Hume Kennerly, who is President Ford's photographer, I just saw him in L.A. when I was out there, I don't know, a month or two ago. You know, Adam Schultz, current photographer. I had a phone call with him maybe a week before the inauguration just to give him my, you know, 2 cents. And then every once in a while, he'll call me with, you know, not sort of a logistics question. I mean, part of it, too, is with him, I know Biden pretty well. So I sort of know, you know, the dynamics of working with Joe Biden in a way that probably nobody else that he can talk to does, you know, from a photographer standpoint. I'm trying to think, you know, Michael Evans, sadly, who was the chief photographer under Reagan, Reagan's first term, died, I mean, at least 20 years ago, I think. And I actually keep in touch with his daughters.
Wow, a special club of people. Next question here.
Hi, my name is Susan Bennett, and thank you so much for the historical record. It's so all the photos are so amazing and beautiful. So you had a team. Was it a large team? I like, if you missed the moment, you had others who were catching the moment, or what? How did that work?
No, so,
you must have worked every day of
so
the
basically,
year?
I did all the behind-the-scenes stuff, right? So if there was a you know, situation or meeting or meeting in the Oval Office or anything where there wasn't any press coverage, I would cover it. I would be the guy. And then we always had somebody document Michelle's solo events. So and they would travel with her when she went on a solo event. Anytime there was like a big like press event, meaning press, there was press coverage, whether it be in the Rose Garden, the South Lawn, or even on trips, I would always have somebody documenting from like sort of the press angle, because oftentimes on those big events, I'm not in the best spot, you know. And for the archive, we want to have the best spot at those big signing ceremonies and so on and so forth. So I think that kind of answers the question. Marianne Fackelman was the first woman White House photographer. She worked under the Carter and Reagan administrations. I worked with Marianne, and she was assigned to Rosalind Carter, and then with primarily with Nancy Reagan during the Reagan administration, and then the last 2 years of Clinton. I think I have this right. Sharon Farmer was the chief photographer for Clinton. Bob McNeely did the first around 6 years, and then he left, and Sharon became the first woman chief White House photographer.
I'm sure there were moments that you photographed that had to be, photographs had to be held or embargoed until a certain point, but was there ever a time that you were asked not to use or release a photo?
Sure.
Or are there photos that are still classified and not releasable until a certain date?
I don't know if there's any that are still classified. There's definitely ones that are still held back for, you know, sensitivity reasons, meaning we made it our practice in the Obama administration not to make public any of the photographs when he was, you know, meeting with families privately, you know, after a tragedy. You know, occasionally there would be exceptions to that, but they were very rare. There's a picture in my book from when he met with the Sandy Hook families 2 days after the shooting, because when I was doing my book, I asked the family specifically if I could use the picture, and then I sort of went through the process with the National Archives. So for sensitivity reasons. And then here's one classified example that I know is a week or two, I can't remember, after the bin Laden raid, we went to some military base, I don't remember where it was, in the U.S., And he met with the entire team, the entire Special Forces team, including the Navy SEALs guys that were the support team, that because they, you know, in case somebody had went down, there wasn't COVID then, but like if somebody got sick, they had replacement teams, right? And so he met with all those teams, and obviously, for sensitivity reasons, they didn't want pictures of those guys out there. So those pictures are, you know, at some point in time will be made public, but right now those have never been made public.
Another question.
Hi, I'm David Adler. The cover of the book, what did you go through to choose that photograph, and what was the second one that didn't make it?
Well, I mean, honestly, I'll try to be diplomatic about this. I don't always agree with publishers on the cover. And it's funny is in my experiences, they've always let me do the book I want to do. Like, I make final decisions, and but not on the cover. And I get really frustrated with that, because this is kind of what I wanted on the cover. It was what's in the back, where the title was going to be in the middle, and this picture was going to be, these were going to be moved down. Because I thought this showed people what the book was about, and this didn't. This looks like it's another Obama book, right? Because you can kind of tell that's President Obama. And I, like, fought it, but I lost. You know, so I, you know, put this on the back, and then here's my favorite part about this book is if you take off the dust jacket and you see,
there you go,
this is what the book is about, you know. So, but like, you know, it's, they're thinking about selling books, and they gotta, you know, we need one picture graphic on the cover that, you know, when it's this small online, people will see it. So that's, yeah.
We uncover
that's the
something.
Story. I hope my book editor's not watching this, because I just threw him under the table.
Okay. Great. Thanks, David. We have one question over here.
Hi, my name is Lee Mosley, and I was curious if there were any particular characteristics or traits about President Obama that you admired or liked and you felt you were really able to capture on your camera and photographs that we could see or that we could not see?
So what you probably didn't see is he's really got a good sense of humor, and he's like the most competitive person I've ever met in my life. You know, and I'm somebody that played spades with him on Air Force One, and it got like, sometimes it got pretty heated, just like a card game, my God. But I think, like, you know, he is obviously a decent human being, and I think you see that in my pictures.
Well, I have one final question that I will pose. In the 222-year history of the White House, there have been 19 weddings hosted by the President and First Lady. Naomi Biden was the recent one, most recent one, and yours was one. Tell us how that came about and what that experience was like.
You know, I'm glad Naomi got married at the White House, since that's now the most recent wedding. And people can, like, stop asking me about my wedding. I mean, so the circumstances were, you know, my wife and I had, my wife Patty and I had been together for like 17 years, had never gotten married. And, you know, the first couple years, she came to a couple events, she met President Obama. She came to Hawaii when we went to Hawaii for Christmas. He used to tell people that he liked her better than me. And then he, like, started, you know, pestering me. Well, why, you know, why haven't you got married? And it came to a head one day on Air Force One. Michelle was on a trip, and we're sitting in the conference room, and he just starts needling me. And he's like, throwing it at Michelle, and I'm like, and then he finally says, you know, we'll have it in the Rose Garden, and I'll officiate. And I was like, sir, I don't want to do that. And he's like, what, the Rose Garden's not good enough for you? He actually said that, and I actually said that to him. And I said, no, I don't want to put you in a position where you do this for me, and then you're going to get pestered by other people. And he said, no. This is just for you. I'm not doing this with anybody else. And so, like, how could you say no to that?
That's right.
And so it became a very, it wasn't Most of the staff didn't even know it was going to take place. It was on a Saturday. It was just my family and a few friends. Very small, little intimate ceremony that lasted for 20 minutes probably in the Rose Garden. And then we, you know, we left and we partied someplace else off campus, if you will, that he didn't go to. And we weren't even going to, I mean, Josh Earnest was press secretary then. He didn't even know about the wedding.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And so it turns out that Kristen Welker from NBC was doing a stand-up on Pebble Beach, or I think they call it Pebble Beach, on the other side of the White House, and heard applause coming from what sounded like, you know, it was probably the Rose Garden, and called Josh Earnest and said, "What's going on in the Rose Garden?"
Busted.
And Josh didn't know. So he called Marvin Nicholson, who was then his body guy, and Marvin was at the wedding. So Marvin told him, and then Josh called me and said, "We have to put out a statement." And I was like, "Oh, no, 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 no." But we had to put out a statement. And then we didn't talk about it at all. That's people just knew there had been a small wedding. And then when this documentary film on me was done in 2020, I think, the floodgates kind of opened, because the filmmakers interviewed me and my wife about the wedding. And then I messaged President Obama, and I was like, "Look, they're gonna talk about this in the film. Is it okay with you if we show some of the photos?"
Well, how did you choose a wedding photographer?
Well, because the president was involved. Chuck Kennedy from my staff photographed the president's involvement in the wedding. Right.
You got a good deal on that.
Those pictures are all at the National Archives.
Wow, good.
Again, and those have never been released, although we did show some of them in the...
So we'll put a FOIA request in today for those.
You could, yeah. Well, when people were, like the AP, Wall Street Journal, a couple other reporters interviewed me before Naomi's wedding and wanted to use some of the pictures, I said, "Well, you're not getting them from me, but if you wanted to FOIA them, you can." But I don't know if they tried or not.
Right. Well, Pete, thank you for doing the book. Thank you for sharing this time with us and telling us even more behind the scenes of your bird's eye view behind the scenes of the Reagan and Obama presidencies. This is really a wonderful service that you do, not just for that president, but for history and the history of the White House. And you yourself have lived so much of White House history and contributed to it. So thank you so much for doing that and for the legacy you've left.
Yeah.
So Pete will stay around. I'm sure he'd be happy to take a selfie or two, and he might let you use your own camera to take a picture with him. Thank you for those of you who are watching on Facebook and YouTube for joining us for this special edition of White House History Live. And thank you all for coming, and have a wonderful holiday. Yes.